Right, C# 9 is with us, and I thought I'd do a few videos just looking at some of the key features in this new release of the language. Now, it's nothing like as big, in my opinion, as C# 8 was. There's nothing as important as the nullable reference types, but there's still a number of nice features in there that make our life easier as programmers. And the one I was going to look at this week is the new keyword init, which is related to properties. So I thought I'd introduce that with a bit of the history of properties to see how they've evolved over the almost 20 years that C# has been around. So let's take a look at that. And what we're going to see here is I'm going to create a new core console application. And I'm doing this right from the beginning just so that we can see the process of making sure our compiler is set to C# 9. So I'll call this init demo. And so we get our basic console application, but the thing to watch out for is if you go into the properties for the project, you can see that it's set as a target for core 3.1. So we just need to change that to 5. That's assuming you've installed it. If not, you need to go to the installer of the frameworks and download the new version. But now we're in version 5. And what I'm going to do is just add a new class. And we'll call this new class simply Person. And then just to show the end of this process, this is what we can now do in C# 9. So if we had a property, let's make it an int age, and then we can replace that set keyword with the keyword init. And that's really it in terms of the code, but in terms of how that changes the way we work, it's quite significant. So before I explain fully what that's going to do, let's actually build this up through the kind of history of properties, because it all started out in C# version 1. We would have had to write a property like this. You had to write a private backing field that you'd call something like underscore age, and then you would write a public property of the same type, call that age, and then you would give it a get where you'd return underscore age, and then you'd have a set where we'd say underscore age equals, and then we'd have this keyword value that's lurking inside every set. It's of whatever type we've got, so int in this case, and that's the value it's being set in. And then that would mean in our program, we could do something like person p equals new person, and then p.age equals 27, and that would be calling the setter because it's assigning into it, and then we could also read that out, so p.age like that, and that will just do what we'd expect. And the reason we have it like this is essentially so that we can put any safety code that we might want to put in here. So although occasionally you might see some safety code on the getter, it's more common on the setter that we might do something like if value is less than 0, throw new argument exception age cannot be negative. So it gives us safety checks around the values we're putting in there. But very often you'd have the situation where you didn't need any safety checks. And so one of the problems with this is in those simple cases, it is quite verbose. And then the other problem is in C# version 1, both your getter and your setter had to have the same encapsulation level. So although we could make the whole thing public or private or even protected or internal, we couldn't have any differentiation between them. So anyone who could read your data could also write your data. That's not very good. So the first big improvement came in C# version 2, Visual Studio 2005, and that was the ability to change the level of protection on either your get or your set. So what we now do is declare the entire thing as public, and then most commonly we then declare the setter as private. And so now we'll see in our program we're getting an error when we try to assign into it. And that explains really this slightly odd syntax, because it evolved from an early version of the language. And that's why you don't just say public get private set, you say public on the entire property and then change usually the setter. It's for backwards compatibility. And once we've got that, now at least we've got decent encapsulation. Now we can say anyone can read the data, only other members of the class can write the data. That's encapsulation. That doesn't solve all our problems, but it means any mistakes are our own fault as author of the person class. No external code can mess things up, but we can still make mistakes for ourselves. The next change came along, C# 3, was the introduction of the auto-implemented property, which meant we could replace all of that with simply that. And so essentially that generates exactly the code I've written there, or would do if I make that one private as well. And the only difference is it chooses its own name for that backing field. So in fact, the backing field is typically called something like age in angle brackets k double underscore backing field, if you were to look at the generated code in the intermediate language, but you can't touch that directly, so it doesn't really matter what it's called, but that's what it gives it. And so in the cases where we don't have any extra bits of work to do, then that's quite a nice feature rather than typing it all out for ourselves. But what that now means is, as we saw, because we've got a private setter, we can't assign an age. And so the normal solutions to that would be something like this. We'd have to give it a constructor. So we give person a constructor that takes an int age, and then we're allowed to say age equals age. And that way, I could have said person 27, got rid of that there, and the code would work just as it did before. But that still may not be entirely what we want, because having made it private, it's still accessible from anywhere inside our code. So I could have some other function. So let's just have public void some func. And in there, I could obviously say age equals 50, which may or may not be what I want to do. But one of the big things that's been pushed for quite a long time in C# is that it's a good idea, when possible, to have what are known as immutable objects, objects that simply can't be changed. And that's not what we've got here with age. We are still allowed to change it. Okay, we're not allowed to change it externally, but we can still change it internally inside the class. And so in C# 6, another variant of this was put in. You'd always, in a manually implemented property, if you wanted to, you could make it get only by missing off the set. But that wasn't possible with an auto-implemented property until C# version 6. What you can do in C# version 6 is, on the auto-implemented property, miss off the setter entirely. And that means it's init only. That means that we can do it in the constructor, but we can't set the age anywhere else. And so that helps us towards making it immutable. So that's a step in the right direction. But that still has one slight problem, because something people like to do lots and lots these days is use member initializers. So if we have a default constructor, then we should be able to say person curly braces age equals 27. But we can't, because the age doesn't have a setter at all. If we gave it a setter, then that will now work, but also we could then change it at any other time, which goes against this idea of immutability. So having removed that setter, that is a bit too restrictive. It now does make it initializable only, but only through a constructor, not through a member initializer. And so that's basically where init comes in. Because if we say init, then we can see it's still not something we can access externally. So p.age equals 50 is not going to work. We can't even access it internally other than in a constructor. So again, if I have my public void sumfunc and then try and say age equals 50 there, again, that gives us an error because it's got the init accessor, but we are allowed to access it in the constructor or in the member initializer list. So that's the big thing we're getting from init. If we missed off the set entirely, we could only access it in the constructor, but with the init, it's in the constructor or in the member initializer list. And that gives us one other slight knock-on benefit as well, which means when we're dealing with manually implemented properties, we can actually now have read-only fields. So if I just go back to my manual implementation. Change that back to the name we had. Get rid of that one for the moment. The problem with that is, if we wanted to say that age was read-only, then we're now getting an error here where we're trying to write to a read-only variable. So we can make that init, and now we know that it's only going to be accessible from the constructor or from the member initializer list, and so that's now working happily. So that's it, a pretty simple idea, just changing that word set to init, but I really think I'm going to find that quite useful because I do use these member initializers quite a lot, particularly when you're dealing with data-rich classes like entities with entity framework and that sort of thing, where you've got lots of data, very little functionality, and so you don't want to spend your time with constructors and that sort of thing. And it was always a problem that you had to have these things changeable. Now we can make them immutable but still initializable, and we're going to see how that's useful in other areas, particularly the new keyword record that we have in C# 9 that we're looking at in a later video. So I hope you enjoyed that. Really quite a quick one, quite a simple idea. We'll be looking at some more complex ideas later on. Do leave a comment if you want to ask anything more about C# 9. Do subscribe, do like the video, and I'll see you next time.